So welcome to MIDWEEK, Experiments in Faithfulness. This is a weekly facilitated spiritual practice with a Quaker flavor and an experimental ethos. My name is Jen, and I'm the program manager here at Beacon Hill Friends House. We're a Quaker Center for Learning in Action and a residential community of about 20 people who live according to Quaker values. Tonight, we have Annie Storr with the practice Exercises for the Quiet Eye. For our practice tonight, you'll want to have a pen or pencil, Annie recommends a pencil, and a piece of paper that can be scrap paper, the back of an envelope, whatever you have near you. Now, I'm excited to introduce you to Annie. Annie Storr is a Quaker scholar, museum educator, and art historian. She is a resident scholar at Brandeis University's Women's Studies Research Center and has devoted her career to exploring the intersection of art, history, and education in theory and in practice. In 2014, Annie had 6 months at Pendle Hill as the Minnie Jane Arts Fellow to polish what we're calling EQE, Exercises for the Quiet Eye, and develop its Quaker resonances. She's a longtime member of Adelphi Friends Meeting from Baltimore Yearly Meeting, and for several years, a sojourner of North Shore Friends in Beverly. Again, welcome. We're happy that you've joined us, and Annie, it's all yours.
Thank you all for coming. As you will learn later, what we're about to do, some slow-looking exercises, grew out of my work in museums, mostly in Washington, D.C., but it became increasingly clear as I got deeper into a project of about 15 years that it was leaning me closer and closer and closer to my Quaker origins. And in the group today, we have several members of several different meetings who have supported this work at North Shore and at Adelphi and at Pendle Hill, and my very dear friend Tara, who is here, who have made this, help me make it more and more Quaker. And so I want to thank you all for that. I'd like to begin, we're going to be looking at images on a screen. So I'd like to begin by sharing a screen and just giving us a moment, kind of an extension of our moment of quiet, but just to invite you to take a quiet moment or two just to look at this image. Before I go on, I'll tell you more about Exercises for the Quiet Eye. This is just just that long, a little over a minute, is five times as long as most adults going through an art museum or looking at a work of art stop to look at it. And so the origins of Exercises for the Quiet Eye come out of my work in museums among colleagues working all over the country who've been part of something called the slow art movement for 15 or 20 years. And the slow art movement has been dedicated to simply helping people slow down and breaking the habits that make us rush. It wasn't Quaker in its origins, but you can see why I've been tapped into those parts of my experience. The average looking time the adult spends looking at a work of art once they've planted their feet is about 17 seconds. Could be 20. I mean, averages are just averages. But it's such a short time that it's impossible for a person looking at a work of art to integrate the three major kinds of responses that anyone has to a work of art, that is sensory and emotional and intellectual. So the very first guiding goal of Exercises for the Quiet Eye was simply to help people support them in slowing down and being suspended so that time could pass, their mind could work, and they could begin to integrate these three parts of looking. What's different about EQE is that though it comes, it's part of art education, it's not about learning about works of art. It's not about learning about artists. It's not art history. It's not even art appreciation. It's a practice designed to focus on the viewer and the experiences of the viewer and helping each person when they're encountering works of art to make it their own in different ways by having more than one way to look and having a kind of support system that lets them slow down. So this is for each of us. There are three major principles behind what has become Exercises for the Quiet Eye. The first is this integration, that making it possible for art to work on us in all of these different ways. And it's the convergence of those three that can give artistic experience its unique power. The second principle, which emerged out of the work, has to do with finding ways to help human beings develop an I-thou relationship, as in the thought of Martin Buber, in which I, the viewer, the human being, recognize the humanity that's embedded in the work of art, by which I don't mean or encourages you to imagine an artist, but rather to find what is human in the art and through a kind of slow, patient looking to develop that human connection. The third major principle behind EQE has to do with developing a tolerance of ambiguity. And I think this is the one that's come to mean the most, is the most important to me and most central to my work as a Quaker, that we can learn from works of art, if we can be patient, if we can allow ourselves to be in a state of not knowing, a state of mystery, we can experience much more. And so part of what EQE was designed to do was to stop people or to help defer the need to figure a work of art out as if it was a puzzle to be solved, and rather to spend time suspended in a place where I'm working on it and it's working on me, but I don't need to understand it. And for me, the importance of the tolerance of ambiguity grows out of the importance of art. The purpose of art, of looking at art, is not to learn about art. The purpose of looking at art is to learn about life and being human. So developing a tolerance of ambiguity is very important as we take it from our art lives over into our all the rest of our lives. And, you know, if we judge a work quickly, try to understand it and judge it too quickly, well, there's a word for premature judgment, and it's prejudice. And so tolerance of ambiguity is something that I try to teach through art to teach us to be more open to the things we don't understand. All right, that's a quick abstract summary of EQE. I'd like to give the basic ground rules. There are 55 exercises in Exercises for the Quiet Eye. We're going to do four, maybe five today, and sort of start with the basics. But there are many, many that we could choose from in this tool and this toolbox. But they all have the same ground rules. One is that in a normal environment, without COVID, without being in our virtual lives, you would be walking into a room with me and choosing what you're going to look at. Because if you're going to have an I-thou relationship with a work of art, it has to be one that resonates for you, not one that I or anybody else decided we're going to look at today and that you should look at. So the closest that I can get in a virtual environment is that I'm going to be putting up two images on a screen for each exercise. And you're invited to choose the one that you would like to work on. For anybody who is conditioned by years of art history, I want you to understand that when I put two images up on the screen, it is not asking you to do a compare and contrast, but rather I would like you to imagine that these are two works of art that happen to be next to each other in an imaginary museum, and you were choosing the one you wanted to give your time to. So the first rule is that you get to choose. The second rule is that we minimize artists and titles because they can be distracting. And so I am very happy, and Jen will help me, to send to you the identifications of the works of art that we're looking at today. But it's amazing how far you can go by simply saying the left one, the right one, not by worrying about whether you can pronounce the artist's name correctly. So we'll minimize the artists. And the third is that nobody ever has to share anything. Maybe not common among Quakers, but and that what's important about that is if the idea is that you have a personal response to the work, that's between you and the work of art. And I don't want you trying to decide what you want to say to the group or what might be the right answer to a question. But to liberate all of that and remove the anxiety of saying the right thing so that you can focus on your time with the art. So with that, I'd like to start with two quite classic exercises, and I'm going to talk you through them. We'll do one, take a little eye break, do another, and then we'll choose how many more to do after we've done those two. So with that, take just a moment to just rest your eyes. Imagine you were in a gallery and you needed a moment just to stare at the floor. And then as I move to the next slide and you'll have two works to choose from, I'll talk you through what I would like you to do. So here you go. Take a moment. Look at them both. Don't rush. And then choose which one of these you'd like to spend a few minutes, give your attention to for a few minutes. And when you've done that, I'd like you to whip out your pencil and your piece of paper. And I'm gonna ask you to make a list of words, the best list of adjectives or short descriptive phrases. And I recommend that you do it in the form of a column. You'll see why later. Whatever descriptive words come to mind as you're looking, don't edit, you don't need to edit them, just let them flow and generate that list of terms. If nouns slip in, if phrases slip in, that's just fine. But in general, we're leaning toward descriptive language for this exercise. If you find you stall out, I'm going to ask you to push through and try to write at least 10. And you'll have several minutes. I'll talk you through. I am told that sometimes it's useful to just grab another piece of paper out of the recycling bin and cover up the one you don't want to look at. And don't worry, it doesn't have any negative effect on anyone else. If your eyes get tired, or if you find you're petering out, just close your eyes for a moment and rest. If you like, if you have your eyes closed, you can pay attention to what the mental image of the work is that you have in your mind's eye. But mostly the purpose is just to rest your eyes. And then open them up and see if anything else begins to flow in the way of words. the words are flowing, let them flow. If you stall for a minute and your list is short, let that happen and then just push on through. And in a moment, I'll ask you to do two more things with your list. When you've had enough, just push back and rest your eyes. And when you're ready, I'm going to ask you to read down your list slowly and choose the three words of all those you may have written. Circle the three words that seem to say the most about your reaction to the work, to say the most about the work part of all the things you've written down. And there's one more prompt. I'd like you to read down your list one more time and pay attention to how you were feeling when you wrote it. So sort of remember how it was as you were making your list of words. And at the moment, at the point in your list where the words began to peter out, or they seem kind of far-fetched, or you only continued because I told you to, or you're getting repetitive, at that point, please draw a line through the words in your list. It's completely possible that the line will be at the very top or at the very bottom, but generally it's somewhere in the middle. It's not just words that you might used to describe the picture. And the three words, well, of all the things that each of you wrote down, there are three, or I could have said five, right, that say the most. So I want you to pay attention where in the list those three words are. And to say that line, let's talk about that line for a minute. There's a lot of research behind this, but the simplified thing to say is that line is the point at which normally you would have walked away from a work of art. It's the point at which your habit of seeing, however you are used to looking at works of art, ran out and you experienced it as stalling or feeling fatigue. And usually that's when people walk away. So in order to keep going below the line, you had to stretch. You had to do things you don't normally do looking. And, or another way to say it is, it's a second wind. I highly recommend that anytime you want to spend some time encountering art, that you do this exercise, because it's a record of your relationship with the work of art. And I think you will find that if you do it occasionally, that you're going to find that the circles drop. And that more and more of the circles begin to be below the line. Another way of putting this is what's above the line is your first impressions. And what's below the line is where you're beginning to stretch and integrate all of the different responses you're having. So we're going to leave that exercise at that, but I suggest you try it. These are all for things for you to do on your own. Let's move on, take a little eye break, because I want to kind of think of this as visual sorbet between the courses. And we're going to do something different. It will appear, just as the last one did, as two works of art, and you're invited to choose one. And once you've done that, I'll tell you what I'd like you to do. But as I put the slides on, I would like you to pay attention to where your eye lands first. And then we'll go from there. So here's a second exercise. Again, feel free to cover one or the other if you find it distracting to have both there. So choose one, make note of where your eye lands first. I'll give you a little time to do that. And then what I would like you to do is to take your choice and pay attention to the path that your eye makes. Just give yourself several minutes to look, noticing the path that your eye travels. And in particular, if you pause and you're looking, make note of it and ask yourself if you know why. And then, like a Ouija board, it may just keep going right on again. And just keep following, but notice that path. And then finally, if your eye comes to rest, make note of that and let yourself rest your eyes. I've had to learn to add one proviso, especially in the virtual environment. If you find yourself going around in circles three times, you're done. Because otherwise you might go around in circles for 25 times. So let me give you some time to just let your eye travel. If you want, you can sketch its path on paper or just be mindful of it watching. Perfectly brilliant man named Rudolf Arnheim, who wrote about art from the 30s until the 21st century, wrote three pages in a set of lectures for the Getty about the difference between seeing and looking. I'm sure neuroscientists would have more to say, but in its simple form, what Arnheim taught me with one little diagram and five paragraphs is that seeing is something that human beings, allowing for difference, optical differences. Seeing is something we all do in approximately the same way. We turn our bodies and our faces toward the thing we're going to see and give it our attention and let our eyes work. Looking, on the other hand, is the process of seeing in a way in which we try to understand what we're seeing. Or put another way, looking is seeing plus thinking. It's a toggle. So that you might start, for instance, You might start here and not know what that swirly circle is. So you look around it to find something else to make sense. And if you happen to be into architecture, you'd say, oh, two swirls, that's a column, that's a capital on the column. I'm beginning to understand. And then I want to know what else. human beings don't like to not know what they're looking at. So we travel in order to pick up a datum, and then the next, and to make sense, and then, all right, what do I need to make sense of next? And we travel around a work of art, building our understanding of it, building a meaning for it. What's really interesting, and I can do this in the gallery with a group of people, is that I ask them to stand side by side, parallel play, like little kids, and look at the work without talking to each other, and then show each other the path that I took. And yes, an artist has a certain amount of control over where you start. There's a big red blotch, that's where you're gonna start, because human beings do that, right? Human beings tend to look for eyes to see if there's a living creature. But beyond that, two people standing and looking at the same work may start at the same point, but in their minds, their individual minds are making sense the way they think. And so as two people are looking together, the paths that they take will diverge more and more and more with each step, because more and more of their looking is in the individual processing the work of art. And it is entirely possible that 2 or 15 people looking at the same work of art will see a completely different work. It's entirely possible to miss some of the people in the picture, or the landscape it's in, or not to notice that there are wolves running towards you. So one person will pick it up, the other one won't. And so we each develop our own relationship by the process of seeing and thinking and seeing and thinking and seeing and thinking, which is looking. I'd like to give you a little sorbet again, and then I think we'll do just one more activity, possibly a very short one afterwards. So here's a little rest for the eyes. This is a short one. You might. Again, I'm going to give you two choices and ask you to choose what you want to look at. And while you're looking, I'm going to tell you a little bit about this particular exercise. It is the only one of the exercises for the quiet eye named after a person. And it's named for David Driscoll, who was an eminent African-American artist and critic and art historian, towering figure in the field, who took me on, mentored me when I was in my first year teaching, and made a comment in a lecture about a year ago that I turned into an exercise. So here's the exercise. After you've made your choice, I'd like you to look at the work, explore it however you like, and then I'd like you to find something you have never seen before. And if you have found such a thing, something in either work, whichever you chose, that you've never seen before, ask yourself this: does it make the work stranger to you or more familiar or closer to you? to have found something you've never seen before. Said in a lecture in Baltimore 18 months ago now. He was asked in a packed auditorium, he's a man with a phenomenal reputation. He was asked by a diffident questioner at the end of a lecture how it was that he chose what he would look at as a critic. Which artist's exhibition would he go see? What did he think was worth looking at? And he said, the first thing is, unless a work of art shows me something I've never seen before. Well, if a work of art will show me something I've never seen before, then it's worth my attention. And that's why I created this exercise, because it takes you into a place where you are by definition not knowing, but you are also discovering more and making the work more your own by discovering something that you didn't before know of. And I will say it has never failed. I've done this exercise now with probably 1,500 people. And they usually look a little surprised when they're asked to find something they've never seen before. And everyone does. So I'd just like you to settle back into looking at this work. Thank you. I thought I'd leave you with a parting word, a parting thought. What you experience about art is not so much determined by which thing you chose to look at as what you were thinking about while you're looking. And all of these exercises are simply ways of nurturing, tugging, leaning you to think one way one time and one way another time. So with that, I'd just like to say thank you to the people of Pendle Hill and of North Shore Meeting. Unfortunately, I don't have a picture of Adelphi Meeting, but this is a workshop of Quaker friends at Pendle Hill above, and then an evening in a blisteringly cold night at Carol Ryan's house. Working on a quilai together. And then the two groups of students at Harvard and the Corcoran, these are research seminars. We spent close to 15,000 hours watching people in the galleries, between 25 people doing the work and watching to see what happened just before they walked away or just before they had a eureka moment, and then built the exercises around helping people to slow down and stay with it. And then finally, a Quaker connection. That this whole method of looking used to be called the Corcoran method of looking, because it grew out of the department I formed at the Corcoran Gallery of Art and Corcoran College of Art and Design. But the Corcoran died. And these exercises fluttered off into the air, and I was given permission to pursue them, and they needed a name. But 40 years ago, a friend of mine who was not a Quaker, but who I'd worked with on some exhibitions, handed me a little tiny book, The Quiet Eye, and said, you need this. But she didn't know I was a Quaker. And The Quiet Eye is a small book that has reproductions of works of art, details most of them on one page, and a short meditational quotation on the other page. It isn't the same method at all, but it's trying to get at the same thing. And the author of that book was Sylvia Shaw Judson, who was a sculptor from Illinois, who was the sculptor of the Mary Dyer in front of the State House. And for those of you who are in the Boston area and know of the design work in playgrounds by Mitch Ryerson, this is Mitch Ryerson's grandmother. So I decided to name the method Exercises for the Quiet Eye after this book in honor of its Quaker origins.